The identification of the remains of King Richard III can be thought of as a historical missing persons case. Richard III, last seen, according to the historical records, in the choir of the Church of the Grey Friars Friary in Leicester.
However, since that time, the friary had been torn down during the dissolution of the monasteries. The excavation that we carried out in 2012 was to first see if we could find what, if anything, was left of the friary, and then, from that, hopefully home in on the area where he could be. In terms of what we were looking for, we knew Richard was age 32 in 1485 when he died in battle. And, from looking at the historical sources, he may have had a spinal abnormality. We carry out the excavation and find the skeletal remains of somebody that looks like it could be him. All of the information from the analysis of the bones is consistent with these being the remains of Richard III. So how does the DNA analysis figure into this case? Well, just as in any missing persons case, you compare the DNA of the person you found with that of a known relative.
It's important to remember that Richard has no known living descendants. So any present-day living relatives are descended from Richard's own relatives, not Richard himself.
And it's important to say here that not just any old relative would do for the DNA analysis. The DNA that we inherit is a complex mixture of just some of our many, many ancestors. Given the number of generations since Richard III was alive, I had to concentrate on looking at parts of our DNA that are passed down through the generations in a really simple way. I was particularly interested in analyzing three different segments of DNA from the skeleton as part of this project. So the first of these was mitochondrial DNA. Now, mitochondrial DNA was interesting for the project for two reasons. First of all, it's in lots and lots of copies in each of our cells. So if you're going to find any DNA left in skeletal remains, it tends to be mitochondrial DNA. The second reason why it's really useful for this case is it's passed down just through the female line. So mum passes it down to all of her children, boys and girls, but only daughters can pass it on. So it means that if I can find a female line relative of Richard, and it can be a boy or a girl, so long as it's an all-female line all the way through the rest of that line, I can use them to act as a comparator. I can look at the mitochondrial DNA of the living relative and see if it matches those of the remains.
The next segment of DNA that I was interested in was the Y chromosome.
So the Y chromosome also has a very simple pattern of inheritance. It is passed down only through the male line. So all men related through the male line should have identical or near identical Y chromosome types.
The third bits of DNA that I was interested in are sections of our DNA that can help predict a person's hair and eye color. The reason why that is interesting is because there's no contemporary portraits of Richard.
So what I was interested in doing was looking at what the DNA was predicting about his hair and eye color, and then comparing that against the portraits that we've got and seeing which is the closest match. So how to find those relatives to compare the DNA to? Well, one of them was already known, Michael Ibsen. He is a female line relative of King Richard III. A member of the Richard III Society, John Ashdown-Hill and his colleagues, had been researching Richard and his family over a number of years. They had previously identified a woman called Joy Ibsen in Canada, who was a direct female line descendant from Richard's sister, Anne of York. Michael is her son, living in London, and happy to give a DNA sample. However, we had to be certain that the genealogy was correct. It's vital to know how a relative is related to the missing person and be certain of that. This is because if there wasn't a DNA match, how do we know it isn't just because the genealogy was wrong? We also knew that our research would be scrutinized, and so it would be important to independently verify this work. This entailed Professor Kevin Schurer and his team looking at a range of documents, including sources such as centuries-old wills, as well as marriage and birth records. Together, they help reconstruct family trees and give documentary proof, as far as you can obtain it, that the family tree is correct. It also allowed us to trace another female line relative, distantly related to Michael, but also descended from Anne of York. This was a woman called Wendy Duldig, who, thankfully, also agreed to take part in this research. Michael Ibsen and Wendy Duldig are 14th cousins twice removed. They are both descended from Anne of York, who is Richard's eldest sister, and they share the same common ancestors for a couple of generations, and then they split off. And it's an all-female line, as you'd expect, down through the generations until you get to the both of them. I was able to take DNA samples from them and look at their mitochondrial DNA. First and foremost, they matched each other, which meant that the family tree linking them was correct. And then they matched the skeletal remains, which again showed that the DNA evidence as well was pointing to these being the remains of Richard III.
In some respects, the work on the Y chromosome and the male line is more difficult than that on the mitochondrial DNA and the female line. I was interested to see if there was a genetic link between Richard and his male line relatives who are alive today.
Now, we always knew from the outset that there might not be a DNA match. And that's because we know from previous research that I and others have done that you get the possibility of what's known as a false or misattributed paternity. This is where the biological father is not the recorded father, and that's going to break the Y chromosome link. We know that there's a percentage for that, and it hovers around the 1 to 2% mark per generation. Still, we thought that this would be an interesting thing to do, just bearing in mind that given the number of generations, that there might not be a Y chromosome match. As Richard was from a noble family, finding male line relatives was very straightforward to do. Using Burke's peerage allowed us to identify a number of people by going up from Richard to Edward III and then back down again through John of Gaunt, and that goes on through the Earls and Dukes of Somerset and eventually the Dukes of Beaufort. We traced 5 living male line descendants of Henry Somerset, the 5th Duke of Beaufort, who lived in the 18th century. I'm expecting that they should all have the same or similar Y chromosomes and that they should match the skeletal remains. Now, doing the Y chromosome work, I found that there wasn't a link between Richard III and the male line relatives who are alive today. Now, this doesn't mean that the skeleton isn't Richard, because what we have already is very strong evidence coming from all the other analysis and from the mitochondrial DNA. The genealogy tells us that they should be related, but the DNA is telling us that there has been a false or misattributed paternity, where the biological father is not the recorded father, somewhere in the 19 generations between Henry Somerset and Richard III. And that's broken the Y chromosome link. The majority of links in the chain, 13 out of the 19, do not affect royal descent at all. It's the remaining 6 links that could do. Breaks in the links on the Yorkist side of the tree could affect the claim to the throne of the Yorkist Plantagenet kings, Edward IV and Richard III. If the break occurs between Edward III and his son John of Gaunt, then this asks questions about the legitimacy of any of John's sons, including Henry IV and his subsequent heirs, Henry V and Henry VI. John's heirs also include Henry Tudor, who started the Tudor royal dynasty. He was descended from John of Gaunt's illegitimate son, John Beaufort, so a break there could also affect the Tudors' claim to the throne.
At this moment in time, we have absolutely no proof as to where that break or breaks occurred. There are 19 links in that chain, 6 of which could affect royal descent. So statistically speaking, it's likely to have had no effect at all. However, it would be interesting to investigate this further to fully understand where that break occurred in the Y chromosome chain.
Finally, while much of the focus of the DNA analysis was on proving that these were the remains of King Richard III, DNA can tell us a lot more than just who you're related to. I was really interested in looking at the bits of DNA which we know can help us predict likely hair and eye color. Now, the reason why that's interesting is because there's no contemporary portraits of Richard. They all post-date his death by about 25 to 30 years onwards, and there are two that vie for being the earliest portrait of him. The one in the Royal Collection, and the one in the Society of Antiquaries of London. Analyzing his DNA, what we've been able to show is that we can say with high probability that Richard had blue eyes, and that at least his childhood hair color was probably blonde, but importantly, we know that hair can darken with age. But if you take this genetic data, we suggest that the most closely matching portrait is the one in the Society of Antiquaries in London, known as the arched frame portrait.
What we've been focusing on here is the DNA evidence. But what we have to remember is that this is just one strand of evidence, one piece of a jigsaw puzzle. And what we have to do in answering the question, is this Richard III? Is bring all of the pieces of the jigsaw together, just as would be done in any missing persons case.
We know that Richard III was killed in battle at the Battle of Bosworth, brought back to Leicester, and buried in the choir of the Church of the Grey Friars Friary. He was aged 32 when he died, and we know that within his lifetime, he was described as having one shoulder as being higher than the other. So, we do the excavation, and we find the remains of a young man. He is in his early 30s. He has got battle injuries and severe scoliosis of the spine, and he's in the choir of the Church of the Grey Friars. Now you can add the radiocarbon data to this, and the DNA analysis, and you can bring all of those strands of evidence together and do what's known as a Bayesian analysis to put a statistical number on how likely this is to be who you think it is. We've done just that. We've calculated the probability of these being the remains of Richard III at their most conservative as being 99.999%. The evidence is overwhelming that these are the remains of King Richard III.